I'm Carolyn Cable, and we're in studio today with Talmadge Ragan, who is the head of casting at SAG-AFI, right?
That's right.
And also, she just became president of Women in Theater organization.
That's right.
And you got a bunch of things going on, so we're going to open up and start talking about
Terrific.
That. Now, we have some clips of you from AFI that I want to show them so they can actually see what's going on, but do you want to set up how you got involved in casting?
Sure. I was a volunteer at the SAG Conservatory at the American Film Institute for many, many years, and about 2 years ago, the people who had been in charge left, and I took over.
And then you just started casting everything.
Well, I'd been involved in the casting process as a volunteer
okay.
for many years, and all of a sudden, it was my baby and in my hands, and it turns out I have a good knack for casting.
You do. Can you just break it down a little bit more? Like when you
sure.
get a script, do you have to go through and do the breakdowns, and do you have to go through?
There are two different ways.
Okay.
For the first year cycle projects, which mm-hmm. is what happens at AFI, 28 films every quarter, mm-hmm. the production team will come in and talk to me and tell me a little bit about what they're looking for, what their story's about. They will tell me particulars, and I can steer them in certain directions if I have people in mind that I think might be good for their parts.
Okay.
But usually they'll just hit the books and go through them themselves, and if they have a dilemma or it's something unique perhaps, then they'll come and talk to me. Now when I cast the screenplays for the second year writers and their teachers in that another program, which I cast about 65 of those a year, screenplay readings, I do break down the script.
That's a lot.
It is a lot.
Okay.
I break down the script very, very carefully, see how many principal roles and supporting roles we have, and then I just start going through the books and the pictures speak to me.
And is there a limit on how many people you can call in?
Or? For the first year projects, yes. They can see 8 principal mm-hmm. actors and 5 for supporting roles.
And for the screenplay readings?
For the screenplay readings...
it just depends on the script.
It depends on the script.
Okay.
I usually try and have maybe 6 people, and some people will do double up on roles.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, it's great for
makes
actors.
Makes it easier.
It makes it a little bit easier, yeah.
Especially on you, because you probably are rushed for time all the time.
Well, yeah, when you're casting 10 films and I've got 9 screenplay readings this week, it's a little overwhelming sometimes.
But you're great at it.
Thank you.
So, Vincent, can we go to the clip, the AFI clip, and see her in action?
Calling you for something else, and I bet Monica.
Thanks, Tommy.
Okay, Monica can help you with that.
Yes, I sure can.
Did you call Jim Gilpin?
Yes.
How are you doing? Oh, that's great. Good, crazy. In a good way. Hold on a second, Gene, okay? Man, what are the chances of that?
Cool.
I love it when stuff like that happens. Wow, so you really like it. Who I just recommended, Gene Gilpin.
And finally, we need a...
Did she just call?
Yeah,
she
was... Yeah, that is so weird.
Excellent.
Finally, we have... There's a man who owns the Magic VCR shop.
Right.
So we need a character who would play that. You know, who's the guy who gives the genie in the bottle, you know,
mm-hmm.
who gives out that thing.
Kind of quirky.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's really an obvious character, eccentric, sage-like, quirky.
Look like Gary?
Like Gary, actually. Gary, have you done this before, and can we use your glasses?
Oh, this is on my glasses.
No, use the keep those.
Really?
Yeah,
they add to the character.
Gary, what's your name?
Zahalsky.
Gary Zahalsky.
Zahalsky.
Yes, you should call him in.
Well, on the same note, I was thinking like also Bud Cort.
Yeah, very, very Bud Cort.
Is he part of this?
Let me.
No, I worked with Bud years ago.
I'm sorry.
I might be able to find him for you.
I would like
him.
I know he's in the Life Aquatic.
Would you mind if she's?
Oh, really? Is he? So I don't know if he'll do it, but I can find him for you. Let me just make a little note.
That's great. How often does that happen where someone can be volunteering for you and a producer comes in or a director comes in and they just happen to be there while you're sitting because you're just like, hey, what about him?
That's the way life happens over there, Carolyn. You just never know. And if somebody's right for it and they're right there in front of me, let's use them.
Right.
Everybody deserves their fair shot.
That's great.
It's great. It really is.
So does it happen a lot? Or not really.
Hard to say.
I just got lucky to actually witness that happening.
Yeah, that was just so coincidental that whole day, and that was a very slow day.
That was a slow day. I know, and I thought this was great because we are not dealing with the sound elements that, you know, would usually be coming up, where it's like everybody's rushing in and out. Because that happens to you a lot.
All the time. All the time. There's a line of people that need to come in and see me right this minute.
Hello, Talmadge, now.
Exactly. It's fun, though.
Question. Now, do you think that this gig helped you get the gig for Women in Theater?
No. You know, I think they have nothing to do with each other. Oh, wow. Although there's several conservatory members who are members of Women in Theater, not at all. I joined Women in Theater when I first moved out here in 89 because I didn't know anybody and I thought it would be a good place to meet some nice people.
And she's smart, too.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. And I've been involved with Women in Theater for many years, some years more than others. I was on the board before. Mm-hmm. But they just called me up a few months ago and said, you know, we really need you to come back. Would you consider being president? And I wasn't sure because I'm pretty busy. But, you know, it's nice to be needed and asked like that. So I'm honored, very honored and proud to be the president.
That was incredible because I remember you calling me and saying, I'm not sure if I'm going to do this, but this is what they asked.
Exactly.
Like, Talmadge, it's great.
It's really wonderful.
And you have a 2-year term?
I believe so.
Okay, great. Now, the other things that you are doing, I know you're fixing up your home for your production company.
That's right.
Your audiobook division.
Exactly.
Do you want to give me like a brief little capsule of how it started?
Oh, I'd love to. I'm so excited about this. My husband, Worth Keeter, and I started Blue Kiss LLC, our production company, several years ago, planning to make some films. Mm-hmm. We still hope to. We've also done some commercials. But for years now, I've been thinking that I wanted to do an audiobook division because I do a lot of voiceovers, and I come from a literary family, and so I know a lot of writers who I think need to have their works known. So Blue Kiss Audio is starting up. I hope to do our first book probably in the next month or so. It's a children's book. Uh-huh. And also in the works, I have collections of short stories by North Carolina authors. Mm-hmm. I have a series of Christmas stories. And I also have a couple of books under contract already.
That's great.
I'm really excited.
New books or books from before?
Books from before. I have some that are in the historical domain, so I don't have to pay for the rights.
Right.
But they're well-known. They should be more well-known than they are.
Okay.
They had won some awards back in the late 30s, and just wonderful literature I'd like to share.
Talmadge, would you share with us, you said that you're from a literary family. Mm-hmm. Would you share a little bit of your history? Tell us who your family is.
Oh, sure. I'm from North Carolina, and my parents were both journalists. Mm-hmm. I grew up in Raleigh, and then when I was about 16, they bought a newspaper down in Southern Pines. My father was the first Secretary of Arts, Culture, and History for the state of North Carolina, and he was also North Carolina's Poet Laureate.
That's great.
He was really, both my parents were really wonderful, wonderful people, and inspired me to want to do some mentoring like he did, particularly my father, for so many others.
Mm-hmm. And are you his namesake?
Yes, I'm named for my father.
Okay.
It's his middle name.
Okay, great. What's his first name?
Sam. Samuel Talmadge Ragan.
Okay. And you have no Reagan history with the past president, Ronald Reagan?
Not at all.
Okay. But the literary connection is very strong with you.
Very much so.
Your mom, also a journalist?
Yes, my mother was also a journalist. That's how my parents met.
Oh.
Working on competing newspapers.
Oh, wow.
And she worked for the newspaper that they owned down in Southern Pines.
Oh, wonderful. And did he publish her work, too?
You know, yes, he did. She wrote a column for many, many years in the paper. She was more the journalist, where he was more the creative writer.
Okay. And did you write for your dad's paper, too?
I sure did. I wrote a column for 20 years.
Oh, this is great.
You might not know that.
I did not know this.
Yeah, it was on the editorial page. It was called It Says Here, and it was about contemporary society. I think it was whatever I wanted it to be about, truthfully. But I think it's really fascinating why people do and say the things they do. Mm-hmm. So I'd write about it. I also had a column called Trends, because I'd been in advertising for so many years in New York that I was kind of a go-getter on what's going to be happening next.
So were you in advertising before you started acting?
Or? No, I was acting since I was a little kid.
Acting always?
Yes, yes. Okay. I was on a television show when I was a little kid in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. But I moved to New York to be an actor, but I didn't know how to get a job. Mm-hmm. You know, in college they teach you how to develop a character.
And your craft and everything.
Yeah. But I didn't know how to get a job, so I got involved in advertising.
But you did bring us some work from an acting demo.
Yes, I did.
You want to set that up? And if that's set up, we'll be going to that next.
This is something I did a couple years ago out here, actually, with a company called Video Symphony. The director is Alan Heim, who many people might be familiar with because he was the editor on All That Jazz. The Bob Fosse movie.
Oh, that's my favorite movie.
Oh, really?
I love that movie.
Yeah, hard to watch at 7 o'clock a.m. on a Sunday morning in a film class, though. That's
what I was. Don't you feel like getting up and dancing, though, every time
you see it? Yeah, every time. So this was kind of an exercise for editors to learn how to cut film.
Really?
Yes, and in this film, First Impressions, it turns out I am the murderer.
Great, let's see you. What are you murdering in this?
No, I'm explaining what happened and why I did it.
Okay, cool. Let's go to that clip. Definitely.
After your dad left, Holly, her demands were overwhelming. I had to sell almost everything. Last night, I came over here to plead with her. She just laughed at me. She told me that you were going to leave me for her, Scott. And she said how ironic it would be that all your alimony checks would be going right back to her, so I'd better ask for a lot. I didn't mean to hurt her. The knife was there. And she kept laughing and laughing and laughing. I could still hear her.
Talmadge, that's great.
Oh my gosh, it's so dramatic.
I know, it was so great. Thank you for showing me. We did a movie together, actually.
We sure did.
This is how I met Talmadge Ragan, wasn't it?
We talked on the phone briefly, and you did a screenplay reading for me.
I did.
But we didn't really know each other.
Until we got on the boat.
That'll do it.
Well, actually, the very first time that we saw each other, I remember walking into the library and looking. I knew that was you. And you looked at me, and you're like, we have the same shirt. I thought, okay, great. We also have the same birth month and
a lot of commonalities. So many things in common.
What I wanted to ask you about was professionalism in the business. Mm-hmm. How important is this? How many people actually act professionally? Because you're in an environment where it must be this way, but I see tons of stuff in the newsletter and the website saying, you know, be professional. So I want to know what's going on.
I don't know what's going on, but it's rampant. People not showing up for auditions, mm-hmm. Changing the rules on the set. I just don't understand it, and that's one reason I wrote that article, Don't Blow Your Shot.
Right.
Because there's so many actors out there who just want the opportunity, and people will take advantage of things and not be the professional union actors we are. It's just unconscionable.
What do you mean changing rules on the set?
There was an incident not long ago. Somebody was on a set, and a principal role, and the person was contracted to work for 4 days. Well, on a Friday night for the next day, he said, well, I'm sorry, I can't be there all day tomorrow because I have an audition in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And the AD and the director's going, what are you talking about? We need you here. Mm-hmm. He goes, I got to go to this audition. And I don't understand people who while they're working, mm-hmm. we're going to take off to go do an audition.
Right.
You make a commitment. If you make a commitment, you follow through. Let's have a little integrity.
You take the work you have before the hope
of
goodness.
The
work.
Yeah.
Now, something happened with us on the set also that it was opposite. The professionalism was, because I remember it was, you might know the time frame longer than I do because that character was kind of crazy, but
right.
It was a very long shoot.
Are you talking about the night on the boat?
The first time
on
the boat, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it was around midnight, and then mm-hmm. my call time was
3 o'clock the next morning?
Right, because I had to be on location at 4 a.m., and here it is midnight. And
we had a grueling day on that boat. Yeah, the thing is, like, with SAG experimental films, mm-hmm. obviously the rules may be changed somewhat. You had to go far away on location, right, to Joshua
Tree or
something?
Yeah, but the rules were not changed.
Not at all. And
the director and producer thought he could change them.
Right, right. And I don't think he realized what travail that puts on actors. I mean, after the day on the boat, which was grueling enough, being in every scene with all the shaking and the quaking of the mm-hmm. boat there, to wrap at midnight and have to come back 3 hours later and drive 2 hours to another location is just not right.
Right. And it took like 4 hours to drive there. And thank God you looked at your watch and you're like, Carolyn, go home. You have a half hour. And it was like, if you even get a half hour to go home, shower, and it was like, you're right.
You were just standing in the parking lot, I think, waiting to be released or something. Yeah. And we were all so tired. And
everybody else had left. I was so glad you came up to me and you said, no.
Well, I was so happy just to be able to go home and get warm and go to sleep.
Yeah.
And you were going to go head out into the desert.
And I did.
I know.
I just went home, showered, and went back. Yeah. But I was very happy that I had a friend there to say, go home.
Yeah, because sometimes we get so caught up in things, we don't really realize what we need to do for ourselves.
As far as people coming in and just stopping by, because in casting offices, nobody likes that. You know, when you talk to casting directors, they say, don't come by and just stop and stay. Like, drop off your picture and leave.
Right.
Do you have a problem with that up at AFI?
Well, I have mixed feelings about that, because as the SAG Conservatory, we want to be welcoming and encouraging to our members.
Right.
However, when you are casting so many things and there's so many like fires to put out, it's really hard to be polite and nice and sociable, even though you might want to, because we do have time constraints.
Right.
So I love to have people drop by, but not all 3,000 at once. You know, it's hard. It really is.
About your type, because in the clip you were playing a murderer, and I'm wondering, because you played such a nice woman in the, you know, the project that we did together. What is your normal type?
You know, I'm not sure. I used to play a lot of neurotic women.
Okay.
I don't know.
What are you asked to play most of the time?
I play a lot of professional people, doctors and lawyer types. I played a real sweet woman last year in a short that I liked, you've seen it. Things to remember.
Great.
Very endearing person, an emotional person who has a connection with people. I think that's what I like.
Yeah. And wardens.
No.
I offered her a part as a warden, and she didn't want
it. I just didn't feel the warden
in me. You're like,
you
know what? I don't think I'm a warden. No, you'd be great at this.
No, I think because wardens are so detached. I have a little more emotional connection, I think.
That's true. Do you know many wardens?
None.
Now, Talmadge, what's up for you next besides the books and things? I know that your husband is a director.
His name is Mark, a writer. Right.
Are you guys planning on doing something?
We'd love to. He has a wonderful script that he's just completed that we're shopping around. Okay. I'd love to see that happen.
And what about for, you know, there's an upcoming festival. Anything going to...
That's right. Well, hope so. I hope it's something you and I can do together.
That would be great.
I've spoken to a writer friend of mine whom you've met, whom we've worked on a panel with.
Yes.
I'm hoping she's writing something for us as we speak.
Talmadge put us on a panel at AFI to teach screenwriters. Basically, they were actors who wanted to get into screenwriting and find out really what's going on in the business. And
how that was a nice afternoon.
It was wonderful. Yeah. I loved it. And, you know, it was great. And one of the writers may be writing a piece for you and I.
Yes,
and
exactly.
And Worth would direct it.
She has one of her short stories, actually, is in my collection of short stories.
Oh, is she from North Carolina?
She is, and my father published her first poem.
Okay. That's great. What, see how connections
work? I know.
Work?
It's really lovely.
Do you feel like everything in your life is coming together?
I do. It all gets better.
You were talking to me about time management once.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
Yeah, I think so. It's hard sometimes. Mm-hmm. You're a very busy woman, as am I, and we have to sometimes say no, although we want to do it all.
Do you think that that's the main thing of time management?
I don't know.
The main lesson?
Maybe so, yeah.
Carolyn? Yeah.
You've got to know your limitations.
Yes, definitely. We have about 5 minutes left of the show. So what I want to ask you about is anything that you feel in your life that may contribute to your art, because you do have many sides to you. You were an advertiser in New York. Like, you were in the who's who in America and in advertising and, you know, so she was a big advertiser. It's not that you were just had a job.
No.
And I think you were casting. Weren't you casting?
I was head of casting for a very small advertising agency back in 1978.
So, I mean, you have, like, tons of experience doing the job that you're doing.
I do. I know. Who would have thought?
Would you like to be casting feature films?
I don't know. You know...
You did cast a feature film. You cast me in that.
I've cast you, in Jacarandas. I've also, this past year, I did another independent film called Love on a Leash. I do it a lot. I think my instincts are really good. But the other side of it is I'm an actor.
Right.
And I'd like to be the one getting those phone calls too, you know. Right. So, but I like to help people.
So do you think your focus is going to be going more into acting? Or
I don't know. It's where the market takes us, I think.
Right.
Especially being a woman over 40 these days, you know. You never know.
That's why you need your friends to write scripts.
That helps.
And your husband to direct them.
Right, right.
It does.
It's a very small community.
Right. Now, you said that Worth was going to be doing the engineering.
For the audiobook company, yes.
That's great.
Yeah. He's a really good editor, and I trust his judgment implicitly.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
I wish that we had, like, video to see how it's going to look, because those rooms are neat. You know, you have a booth, right?
We're getting a booth. It will be delivered next week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
and you're going to put up soundproofing and padding?
Well, it's included in the booth.
Oh, it is?
It's a separate entity, yeah. So we've got our new Pro Tools ready to go, and we've got the mic ready to go.
So if this was the room, would it be just freestanding in the middle of the room?
It's about a 4x4 space.
Oh, how wonderful.
Enclosed, and soundproof windows.
So you had to change everything around for this?
We're in the process of doing it now. You can imagine.
I could imagine. I think that's wonderful.
Yeah, we're really excited about it.
Okay. We have 3 minutes left now.
Okay.
I'm giving you the signals because I know you can't see them in back of you.
Right.
But that's why I keep looking over
that's
there.
That's fine. That's just fine.
Talmadge, you said that you don't know what your type is, but you play lawyers and you play professional people,
mm-hmm.
and you play any assorted number of things. Is there anything that you would not like to play? There's something that you just, it's just against your integrity as a person.
You know what? That has never presented itself to me, but I dare say that probably there is something out there like that. I don't know what it would be.
But you never read any of this stuff at AFI and go, you know what? I just wouldn't do it. Like, you don't cast yourself.
No, I don't. I auditioned just like everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe there was one part a couple of years ago that I wasn't comfortable with. I don't remember what it was or why.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but like I've spoken with you, we all need to trust our instincts.
Mm-hmm.
And if something doesn't feel right, don't go there.
Right.
Not to say that people won't see things in us that we might not see in ourselves.
Right.
And we need to, like, stretch as actors to maybe explore things we haven't explored.
Do you sing?
I do sing.
And do you dance?
I used to dance.
And
but one thing you asked about what contributes to the spirit of my acting,
mm-hmm.
I do play the piano.
Oh.
And I find that's very relaxing and kind of gets you in tune with yourself.
Mm-hmm. Daily?
No, I should.
Keep up your practice.
Yeah, that's right.
That's true. A lot of people have told me that there are certain things that they know they will not do.
Uh-huh.
And
do you have that?
There are definitely things that I wouldn't mm-hmm. do. Most of the stuff that people ask me to do, I always think, why would they want me to do this? But I realize it's because I can, and I can show that, and I can connect with the characters.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily the things that I want to do.
Right.
But it sort of feels like I need to be doing this.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, they wouldn't ask me to do it. And it always turns out to be better for me, and I grow from that. So
I think you're exactly right. Sometimes when we're reticent about doing something, if there's a slight little inkling that we should try,
mm-hmm.
I think it's great to go there because it usually comes back to you
right.
tenfold.
And usually it's the ones that you don't want to do. Those are the ones you need to do.
And also you learn from the most.
Yeah, you do learn the most from them, and that's always the one that I'm like, okay, because I have this feeling I don't want to do it, that means I got to look at it, and
yeah.
I need to talk to people. And
and likewise, you don't want to be
tell them what I don't want to do, and then they'll talk me into, no, you can do that. But yes, we're getting the wrap-up signal right
okay.
now.
Okay, well, thank you so much for inviting me.
So
appreciate it.
Thank you so much for coming on and sharing all your information.
Thank you, Carolyn.
And telling us about, you know, your production company and what you're going to be doing in your life, and hopefully we'll get a project going soon.
I hope so. Thank you so much.